for the organizers of this event to have called me here and to share some of my thoughts with you. I am somewhat of a misfit in this gathering because I belong to, I can see, I think as far as I can see, to a different generation of, people, especially Muslim scholars and Muslim activists. I belong to that generation that smiled in the face of discrimination and tried to ignore it. Even when we were comfortable, even when we were pained, we would, sometimes not really feel that there was that political opportunity or that strength of spirit to actually raise our voices against it. Sometimes it is not only individual strength. Sometimes it is not only individual strength, but also history that creates political opportunities for people to rise and to raise their voices. It is this movement that also has created space so that not only voices can be raised, but the rest of the political community of, this country is also forced to listen to these voices. So I think it has to be given to this movement that those voices have been created. In some of my work, I've said that an act of speech is not completed unless somebody is heard. And it is not as if Muslim community did not have a political understanding of what were their problems. It was not as if they did not understand who their oppressors were. It was not as if that they did not have an understanding of what possibly might be a way out of such situation. But the state of limbo was there for such a long time, probably, because the facade had to be kept up. This idea that Muslims are not invested equally in the project of nationhood of India was that great burden on the shoulders of Muslims that kept them quiet. In recent times, so many times we have heard, is it the responsibility of only Muslims that India should remain secular? Are they the only community that has to pay price, that have to make sacrifices to keep India secular? Is it in interest of all other communities or not that the secular character is preserved and saved? Or is it that now everybody is sort of gotten on to this Hindutva bandwagon, and this is what the new India is all about, in which of course it is the text of this law that creates this specter of Hindu nation and exclusion of Muslims from the idea of India. So all of this was known, but what was not there was that if you were speaking about all this, then who cared and who listened? The voices that were there in the name of Muslims, who were speaking for Muslims, were busy playing the game of good Muslim and bad Muslim. And the dynamic of this, dyad of good Muslim, bad Muslim is, as Mahmood Mamdani himself has shown quite clearly, is that the idea that there are good Muslims and bad Muslims means that when the chips are down, everybody is a bad Muslim. It is by definition in that idea that everybody is a bad Muslim. And it doesn't help, of course, Muslims in India that there is such a thing called global Islamophobia as well. So you can just continuously call into question the ideas that are already prevalent in international community of about global Islamophobia, and then whip up the old fault lines, all the old hatreds, etc., that already existed in India. So, to talk about Sharjeel and what Sharjeel said and what it was supposed to have meant and why it meant that this such draconian, what are known as extraordinary laws can be slapped on him without even having any pretense of any preliminary investigation or any evidence of anything unlawful actually having happened. And of course, there is a lot of criticism also from amongst people who are supposedly on our side about how, one, that whatever he said was wrong, two, okay, maybe what he said was not wrong, but he was stupid to say it, that, you know, those words were used, that it is idiotic, it was foolish, it was stupid to say those things. Now, interestingly, one of the greatest criticism of that 40-minute speech that Sharjeel made in AMU was that he never once criticized BJP and RSS. I am speechless. I am speechless at that. But this is exactly what, you know, Ghalib said when he said, and how can a Muslim make a speech without throwing in a shade, right? So Ghalib said, वो बात जिसके फसाने में कोई जिक्र ना था वो बात उनको बहुत नागवार गुजरी है. बट आई मीन टू दो एवरीबडी प्रेजेंट हेयर, इट्स अ नो ब्रेनर, इट्स अ नो ब्रेनर दैट ही डिडंट से एनीथिंग अबाउट आरएसएस एंड बीजेपी, दैट ही डीम्ड इट कंप्लीटली वेस्टफुल टू लूज एनी एनर्जी ओवर क्रिटिसाइजिंग आरएसएस एंड बीजेपी. डोंट वी ऑल नो व्हाट दैट क्रिटिसिज्म इज? Do we have to keep repeating it all the time? But I would go even a step further and, you know, make another claim. Well, a completely ridiculous claim, actually. Which is that maybe we shouldn't criticize BJP and RSS so much. Because if it weren't for the fact of intensification of what has been happening to Muslims in the last 5.5 years, then maybe this movement would not have had the political opportunity to come together. So thank you, Modi ji. Thank you, Modi ji, for creating this political opportunity. It's ridiculous that Muslims have to, whenever they speak, they have to say certain things in order to be considered good critics in this one's eye or that one's eye. And there are terms of references that you must first say this, then say that, and only say it in this sequence for it to be acceptable to other people. And you know what else can you say about these terms of references and this movement? The core demands of this movement are, of course, that there is a discriminatory law. There is a law that goes against the very fundamental tenets, the values of the Constitution of India, which are, nobody can have a dispute that they are good values. So then if those are to be, adhered to, then is there anything else that we can also, in this movement, what else can we say that these are the limits of the language of this movement? And this discrimination, if let's say, inshallah, this movement, this law is repealed, and if NRC and NPR are not able to actually gain any traction in this country, so the core demands of this movement are met, then would we deem that this movement is successful if the terms of references regarding the speech of Muslims do not change? If you are still bound by that, what you can say, what you cannot say, how do you have to appear in public, what you will not say, and you will be completely nationalistic, etc., etc. If those don't change, then I think this movement would have been really limited. So it is precious. This movement is precious only if it is widened and if it changes those terms of references of what can be said and what cannot be said. And that to me is something really important. What does one say about rest of Sharjeel's speech? What is this idea of India? And who are Muslims? In the idea of, where is nation constituted? So, you know, all of you in JNU would be really familiar with the theories of nationalism, etc., etc. And the idea is that nation is an imagined community. Where is this imagination lie? There is a collective imagination, collective memory of who we are as a cultural community. And who we are, there is a history to that. And nationalism, as Rana very famously said, is about getting your history wrong. It's about getting your history wrong. You have to decide which part of history will you remember and which part of history you ought to forget. And when you say you forget this history, that is paradoxically also an act of remembrance. You have to remember whatever somebody is telling you to forget. And partially, what Sharjeel has been doing in his writing and in that speech that he made was also reminding us what we have been told to forget. So we have to constantly contest this idea of what India is, what the idea of India is, what its history is, and the space of Muslims as subalterns in India. Who is a subaltern? Gayatri Spivak said that a subaltern is, the word subaltern is not a fancy word for poor. Working class people, poor people are oppressed, but they're not subaltern. Who's a subaltern? A subaltern is a community whose history, whose memory has been written out of the official historical account. What is the historical account of who we are as a nation? Out of that, where is the history of Muslims? Where is the history of what they have done to be invested in the cause of this land that they belong to? What other land do we know of? If the, one of the things that this movement have been successful in saying is this. When the movement participants say ki hamare purkhe zameen mein dafn hai, ye mitti hamari hai, ye zameen hamari hai. Jab wo kehte hain ki hum paanch waqt namaz padte hain aur sajde karte hain is zameen pe, वो क्लेम है. एंड लुक एट द रेवोल्यूशनरी स्पिरिट ऑफ दिस क्लेम. इट इज द क्लेम इज दैट वी हैव प्रैक्टिस्ड आवर रिलीजन हेयर. नॉट जस्ट दैट वी हैव बीन बॉर्न हेयर एंड वी हैव डन अदर थिंग्स हेयर, वी हैव लिव्ड हेयर, वी हैव डाइड हेयर, वी हैव कॉन्ट्रीब्यूटेड टू इट्स डेवलपमेंट, ऑफकोर्स ऑल ऑफ दैट. बट नॉट ओनली दैट, बट वी हैव प्रैक्टिस्ड आवर रिलीजन हेयर इन विच एवर वे that was allowed to us, that we were able to do, etc., etc. So that's the claim that this movement is making. And the claim that Sharjeel is making is to push the boundary of that language of claim making, the boundary of the remembrance of what is our stake in the history of this country. And that becomes, of course, seditious. Why is it seditious? It's actually very obvious from the text of this law itself. It is seditious because it is redefining the country as a country that has no empathy for a Muslim. When I go for many of these sit-in protests where most of the protesters are Muslim women, I speak to them and many of them told me, "Hame koi aitraz nahi hai." Of course, the propaganda against the protesters were that why are you against giving citizenship to people who are persecuted elsewhere? And most of the places I was told by the protesters that hame koi aitraz nahi hai, agar kisi ko kahin pareshan kiya ja raha hai to aap dijiye unko citizenship. Hum to Allah se dua karte hain ki India itna develop ho ki puri duniya ke persecuted jahan se jahan ke bhi ho, वो जब यहाँ आए और वो कहें कि हमको पनाह चाहिए तो इंडिया उनको पनाह दे सके. इतनी जेनरोसिटी है. और आप कह रहे हैं कि आप इतने तंग दिल हैं कि आप पाकिस्तान, अफगानिस्तान और बांग्लादेश की माइनॉरिटीज को नहीं आने देना चाहते. सो दिस इमेजिनेशन ऑफ इंडिया एज दिस लिमिटेड स्पेस विच ओनली हैज प्लेस फॉर सर्टन कम्युनिटीज एंड एक्सप्लिसिट एक्सक्लूजन ऑफ वन कम्युनिटी is not the idea of India that is shared by these protesters. That idea of India is completely different. It is completely inclusive. And it is a place where these aspirations can be held. What are these dreams? What are these aspirations? That reminds me, of course, of the Mumbai Pride, where Chris and some of their friends were raising the slogan, which was found seditious. The slogan was, they raised the slogan, they said, "Sharjeel, tere sapno ko hum manzil tak pahunchayenge." Why is "Sharjeel, tere sapno ko hum manzil tak pahunchayenge," the aspiration, is seditious? Why is it seditious? And one of my friends actually, in a very funny tone, he said, well, imagine, what is it that Sharjeel dreams of? What are Sharjeel's dream that are so scary to people that if they were to be realized, it would be completely unacceptable? His dreams are equal citizenship for Muslims as well. His dreams are that their history is also preserved and remembered. His dreams are that social justice that is extended to, at least in theory, if not in practice, to other groups in the community are also extended to Muslims. How are the realization of these dreams, how is it seditious? Again, that is also in the text of this act. These dreams are seditious because the realization of this dream is realization of that idea of India that scares Hindutva powers. Take one more example that to me at least proves my theory, which is the example of Amulya in Bangalore raising another slogan which got her charges of sedition. What did she say? From her post, of course, we don't even know what was she going to say in full, because the moment she read the first slogan, she was heckled, mic was taken away from us, from her, and she was taken off the stage, immediately taken into custody. It was so scary for people. But to extend empathy, but to extend life, the slogan Zindabad, what does it mean? The slogan Zindabad and Murdabad. I have a friend who actually hates the Murdabad slogan. She's like, no matter how much I dislike somebody, how much I'm against that person, I cannot wish death unto them. So here is Amulya who's wishing life unto somebody. And we know from her Facebook post that she wished happiness, life, goodwill, extended goodwill to every country in the world. That's what she wished to do. But to extend that empathy and goodwill to Pakistan, which of course our country has not declared officially to be an enemy nation, but Owaisi Saab said that Pakistan is our enemy. We cannot, accept these slogans. So anybody who's a good Muslim needs to be also a person who wishes death unto Pakistan and wishes bad things for Pakistan. Then you are a patriot or a nationalist, but otherwise you are a seditious person, you are a deshdrohi. So not only Hindustan Zindabad, but you have to wish death unto Pakistan. Until you are such a person, it is not that your nationalism is acceptable to us. So, to accept that Muslims are equal citizens of India, to have non-Muslims extend empathy to them as their equal compatriots, and to extend empathy to all and any Muslims in the world as also equal human beings who should have right to happiness and good life, is seditious in India? Is this the country that we want to live in? But I said in the beginning that I'm somewhat of a misfit in this gathering because I belong to a generation that spent a lot of time being scared and iffy and not saying few things. But on the other hand, I also belong to a generation that cares for solidarities. Partially, I'm yet undecided whether it is because of our ingrained fear that we are not as brave as all of you are. And probably as I've learned so many things from you, I will also learn that bravery a little more. So we'll do that. But I think if we are contesting an idea of India that is exclusionary and hateful, then we cannot do it without care. Then we cannot do it without extending empathy. And we cannot do it without making as inclusionary as possible. Just as the women in Shahid ga, who were sitting and protesting there, told me. So I think in the end, I think the sedition law or any other extraordinary laws, and I mean, funny thing is that it's not as if in India this is the first law that has been made which is exclusionary and discriminatory. We have plenty of such laws. And we have so many such laws that it makes me a little pessimistic about whether this is just one more law added to that list of discriminatory laws, or that there's something so uniquely blatant about it that that it has invoked this kind of opposition. So, of course, movements are very fickle things. There is, you know, not much that you can predict about them. This movement, like rare movements, is also a movement which was completely spontaneous. There are hardly any faces or any names that you can name as leaders of this movement. So, what will happen to this movement in the face of violence that has been unleashed upon not only the movement participants, those who have dared to come out of their houses and speak in the public arena, they've made an appearance, they've made a claim to equal citizenship and equal humanity. But there are also scores and, you know, even millions of other Muslims who have gone home. And then, ghar mein ghuske marenge is not just a slogan anymore. I would be a fool if I said I'm not scared. But as Afreen said, and as one of my favorite shayar has said, Amir Aziz, that it is not necessary that when we are scared, we will be paralyzed because of fear. When the fear reaches such limits that it actually propels you into action, it doesn't paralyze you, it propels you into action, which is unprecedented. It makes you do the kind of things that you've never done in life. Right? So yes, you have power. Yes, you have might. Yes, you have managed to scar us. Yes, you have managed to beat us up. Many of us are killed. But yes, it is also that the veil over oppression of Muslims has been lifted. I don't think that there are many people who have an iota of shame and humanity left in them that can now contest that this is not the case. We have spent decades trying to talk about the situation that we are in seminars, in public gatherings, trying to do advocacy with political parties, trying to meet our so-called token leaders, trying to talk about this oppression, but failing. But now, definitely, no more such failure awaits us, at least in articulation. Nobody can deny that this has happened. And nobody can now avert their faces from the fact that this has been happening for a long time, even though there was a veil over it. And that veil was the veil of civility. If one said that the ideas that are written in this book, Constitution, that you hold to such lofty values and so on, those ideas have not really worked for us. And our aspirations are that we ask you to make it work. We couldn't even ask that. We couldn't say for all these decades that these ideas have not worked for us. You make it work. And today, at least, we are able to say that, even though it is still seditious to say that. It is still seditious to say that, but we are saying it. So I think Sharjeel must be credited with pushing the limits of what can be said and creating in this space, in this movement, also a space for scholarly voices, for scholarly criticism. Of course, there are popular framing, there is colloquial framing. People from their own tacit knowledge are talking about what had gone wrong, why they were not able to speak all this long, what is their understanding of the idea of India. People have said it clearly enough. But are there any scholarly wise voices also who are putting together this criticism and saying this is what it is? And I think some of us, for example, the kind of work that I have tried to do in scholar even gained traction because one couldn't even say those things in seminars. And the first time aggressive questioning happens to you in a seminar, you're kind of, as a young scholar, you're taken aback. But then you talk to other scholars and you understand that it happens to other people also. You speak of something new and they're like, what are you saying? I don't understand you. What are you saying? This is completely wrong. Who is the Muslim that you're talking about? A Kashmiri Muslim is so different from the Kerala Muslim. There is no Muslim that one can speak about. But if women can be talked about, if Dalits can be talked about, surely Muslims can be talked about. Surely that's a category. Despite their diversity, despite their heterogeneity, I think there is a thread of oppression that unites all Muslims. That's the commonality of experience. So I thank Sharjeel for what he said. There is nothing wrong in what he said. In that collage of criticism that he created in that speech, borrowing as we all do from other scholars' work, standing on the shoulders of giants, as we say, he put together an act of speech for which for long there has been no audience. And now the audience has begun to listen up. They have begun to listen up, unfortunately, only because there has been such violence. It is because of this violence that they have been put into this situation of guilt where they have to listen about it. But well, we have to take whatever we get and make the best of it. So I think all of these tragic happenings that are going on around us, if they are making us sharper in our thinking, if they are making us clearer in our articulation, then I guess in the long run, for our children, for your future generation, it would have been worth it to go through all this. None of this would have been a waste. Thank you so much.